Hallelujah. Good evening, everyone. Good evening, everybody. It's about that time. Welcome to WinsDay. Yes, come on, give God a round of applause. This is our WinsDay night. We are truly being blessed by the revelation that God is releasing. I mean, I don't know about you, but I know I've been learning so much. How many have been learning so much? Last week, woof. Last week was just so amazing, so powerful. And we know that today is going to be even better. It's going to be even greater. Anybody expecting that? Anyone expecting today is going to be even better? It's going to be even greater. So we thank God. I know that, you know, it's the middle of the week, hump day, like everyone says. But we want to take our minds off of work and off of everything that has happened. And let's just take this time to focus on Him. Let's focus on our Lord Jesus. Let's focus on how good He is. Let's focus on how wonderful and how marvelous He is. Father, we thank You this evening. We thank You, Father, because You've given us this great and wonderful privilege to come and separate this time, to come to Your house, to honor You, to acknowledge You, to bless Your name, and to go deeper in knowledge, to receive revelation of who You are, O Lord. We bless our bishop and our pastor on tonight. We know that You're going to use both of them in a mighty and powerful way. So we open up our hearts, we open up our minds, we get ourselves ready to receive everything that You have predestined to pour out and to give us on today, Lord God. We will not allow anything that has gone throughout the day, anything that has transpired throughout the day to stop us from receiving what You have destined for us to receive on tonight. So we put up all of our attention on You. We put all of our focus on You right now. We put all of our attention on You, God, because You are a great God. You are a good God. You are a mighty God. And there are not enough words in our vocabulary to express how good, how great, how wonderful, how marvelous You are. So we want to open up our mouths, open up our hearts in adoration and praise and worship towards You right now in this moment. We worship You, O God. We honor You. We adore You, Lord. We adore You. We adore You, oh God. Come on, open up your mouth right there where you are and just begin to honor the name of the Lord. Begin to honor and bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let your worship rise on tonight. Let your worship rise on tonight. God, here we are to honor You, to bless You, to worship You. We do not take this moment lightly. We do not take this moment for granted, no, Lord God, but we savor this moment. We enjoy this moment with You, and we honor and bless You. We thank You, oh God. Hallelujah. Come on and bless Him. Come on and bless Him, church. Come on and bless His holy name. Come on, say wonderful things to your God. Hallelujah. We bless Your name, Jesus. Oh, Lord. Light of the world, You step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart. With You. yeah. Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy. Holy. Are you Lord God Almighty? So worthy is the Lamb. Oh.
Almighty Creator, you are. But a high
that is grateful. It's a heart that is grateful for who you are. You take the first place. So we honor you, Lord. Yes, we honor you, Lord.
We've come to, thank you, we've come to honor him tonight. We thank Jesus and we thank George. Man, what a presence that. Let me tell you something. When I walked out of that room, and I looked up at y'all, it looked as if the whole church was going like this. And that is a beautiful thing. It was like we were tapping into corporate worship. Wasn't just individual worship, though that's what corporate worship is made of. But as George was leading us tonight, it felt like it was corporate worship. It was beautiful. Will you just turn around and hug somebody? Tell them I'm glad to see you in the house of the Lord. Glad to see you tonight. Y'all may be seated, and I want to just say thank you so much for being here for the last four Wednesday nights that we've talked about Tabernacle Truths, and your presence says everything. The fact that you came and you've been consistent to come, and if this is your first, Tuesday, Wednesday night, we know you are watching online. We just know it, okay? But I want you to write something down real quick. I asked Bishop if I could just give you something before he begins to speak to us. And I think it's important because I think it'll help you to understand why you press your way on a Wednesday night.
Yes.
And what it actually means. What I want you to write down, I'm going to give you seven words. And I'm going to explain just briefly about those seven words. So the first word I want you to write down is information. Information. Now, the first step in order for us to move to into divine growth or into, I guess I can sit down, right? I'm not used to that. Into divine growth is that's understanding and getting into the Word of God. The first step, I'm giving you seven steps. So the first step that we come to is the word information. And without a working knowledge of the information that is in this book right here, then we can never really go any further. And a lot of people come to church, they get to know Jesus, and but they never get into the book for themselves. So they don't have a working knowledge of the Word of God. So you can just forget about going on to any further steps that I'm going to show you if you don't have a working knowledge of what is in the book. And so we all know that he chose to reveal himself to us through his written word. Isn't that right? That's how God reveals himself to us. So we have to have a certain working knowledge of the Word of God. And so we call that the first step, which is information. The second step then is illumination. First one is information. Second one is illumination. And whenever your information becomes a lamp unto your feet and a light unto your path, when the light of the Holy Spirit sits down on the information that you know, then it begins to illuminate your information. So that's step number two. First step, information. Second step is when the Spirit of God rests on that information and it becomes illumination and it lights our path and it guides our feet. Illumination then leads us to the third word, which is inspiration. Inspiration. I need to probably slow down just a little bit so y'all can write that down. Inspiration. The Holy Spirit that is within us, he receives the word of the Lord with joy. Okay, we know that, that the Holy Spirit within us receives the word of the Lord with joy. And as we begin to receive it from him, the Holy Spirit that is within us, then it begins to bring inspiration to our lives. So the first thing we have to have is we have to have the information. And then the second one is the word becomes illuminated in our life. It leads us and guides us into all truth. And then we are inspired by what the Spirit of God has led us and guided us into. And inspiration, what inspiration does is it makes you hungry for the word of God. So it's like your hunger that creates that hunger within you. Matthew 5 and 6 says to us that the Holy Spirit makes us hunger and he makes us thirst after what? After righteousness. And so when we find ourselves hungering and we find ourselves thirsting for truth, what that really means, because no person can make you hungry for this word, okay? Right. There has to be something in you that is hungry, and that's the Spirit of God within you. And when you find yourself hungry for the word of God, what that means is God is giving you an invitation, right, to receive a greater level or a greater revelation of the word that he has for us. So inspiration then leads us to number four, which is revelation. Somebody say revelation. So revelation really is the result of the transcribed word, which is the word I have right here in my hand, or the logos word, the word that is written. It's the result of this transcribed word moving from the logos to the rhema. It's the result of the word of God moving, let's say it like this, from our head, now it's down into our heart. So that it goes from logos to rhema. That's when it becomes a revelation. It goes from the transcribed word to the living word. And that living word is what brings about a revelation. Revelation truth, it makes the truth in that we're hearing, it makes it become a living person to us. And as we respond to the revelation of that divine person, as we begin to yield our will and we begin to yield our minds and we begin to yield our emotions, as we begin to yield that to that divine character, that person of holiness and righteousness that is within us, it begins to unveil the Christ that is the life of Christ that is within us. Are y'all following me? Okay. And then once the Holy Spirit begins to breathe and there is revealed truth in our spirits, then that becomes our life. In other words, it becomes the meaning of our life. And we actually experience what we had previously only heard, because now we are inspired. Somebody say inspired. So as we grow in the divine growth process, we come to number one. The first step is what? Second step is? Third step is?
Inspiration.
And the fourth step is?
Revelation.
And then we move to the fifth step, which is the realization. So realization is the recognition that this word that I am hearing is changing my life through my obedience to this word.
Right.
Now, once we hear it, we're accountable for it. Y'all following me? And the more we become accountable for it, and the more we submit ourselves to it, it begins to change us. And we begin, the revelation that has become a part of our life, it begins to change us. Are y'all following me? Okay, and so this takes us then to step number six, which is, hold on one second, let me find it, because I just wrote all this as I was going out the door. Tell me the points again.
Information, illumination, inspiration, revelation, realization.
Okay, that's five. Number six The sixth step that we move to in the divine growth process then in the word is transformation. Okay? Transformation happens as a result of the rending of the veil of flesh. So as the veil of flesh begins to rend or begins to separate, it rends our self-centeredness. It exposes that. It exposes our lack of love. It exposes our sinful nature. It exposes our ungodly tendencies. And when those are exposed, and we begin to realize that the word is transforming my life. There is a transformation that has happened to me, and now my desire to seek after him and to do away with the old man and let the new man manifest himself, and the way that is realized is by we start loving our neighbor as we love ourselves. And we stop preferring ourselves. But now it's about what would Jesus do? Because you know why? Because the word has transformed you. The hearing of his word has transformed you, which leads us to the seventh step, and I'll stop. Seven is manifestation. Okay? It's the manifestation of the character of Jesus in our lives. And it's when we turn, that is when we turn in the nature of Christ, is what begins to manifest in us. It's no longer you make me man and before I think about it, I have ran you over or cut you off. But no, I began to think I can't do that. I can't act like that because the word has changed and it began manifesting in my life. So here we go. I wanted, the whole reason I wanted to say all of that is because there is something in you that makes you come back Wednesday after Wednesday after Wednesday, and it's because you're on a journey of acceleration. Okay, you're going from just information to illumination to inspiration to revelation to transformation and to manifestation. Okay, and realization, I left that out. Okay, your turn. Tag, you're it. I just...
Acceleration.
I didn't, but man, that would work. We can just build us a little message right here. Yeah, which accelerates us from the average person who has no hunger, who has no desire. All they want is church. Okay, that's why they never get in the book anyway. Because all they want is the experience of church. Look at somebody and tell them, I want more.
Hallelujah.
Absolutely.
I love all that. It's absolutely. We can stand now. Get your seed ready. Amen.
Not that easy. We're hungry.
We just got fed.
We're still hungry. Amen.
Incredible. Today I ran across something Instagram that, and I'm trying to think of the pastor and prophet's name, just recently passed, maybe last year. Where's the George at? Times Square Church. What was that pastor's name?
David.
Yeah, that was it. I was thinking somebody, first name. David Wilkerson, thank you. This was in 1978. He prophesied, you all, in prophetic utterance, you're always prophesying. The word prophesy is future foretelling. You're telling the future, but you're telling it as though it's now, because it's present to you from a prophetic utterance. You literally shift into the future. The prophecy shifts to the future, but yet you feel it's present because it's coming now. And he began to prophesy about this season that we're in. And one of the things I recognize that he's been a phenomenal pastor, Times Square Church, New York City, phenomenal pastor and a prophetic general for many, many years. And so I validate from me personally his words and the life that he lived. He began to talk about where we are now. And he was prophesying in 78, talking about where we are now. Because you understand, when you tap into the prophetic, you're tapping into the mind of God.
Yeah.
And releasing the voice of God through you as a channel. So God has total oversight. He sees the end from the beginning and the beginning from the end all at one time. He sees your past, present, and future from the same level of oversight at the same. So he sees my past, present, and future at the same time. And so he was prophesying as though it was now, and it was 1978, how that we're getting ready to experience calamity like we have never experienced. On land, watch this, on land and sea. It captivated me on land and sea. And then he went through several different things concerning the land and sea. He said, there will be divine disruption. Now, I know for a fact in 78 and 80 through the 80s into the 90s, the word disruption wasn't really used in church unless somebody was causing trouble where they do disruptive. But we would just call it sowing division. Schism and all that. And he said there'll be divine disruption. And get this, he said, I wanted to say this later, maybe the next time I speak, but it was so in my spirit to release it tonight. Then we'll go into the tabernacle. He said divine disruption we will see. And he said at that time of divine interruption, there will be groaning from the earth. And the groan from the earth, according to Romans 8 and 19, 8 and 21, if you want to write it down for reference, you can look at it later. But the groan from the earth, and he talked about volcanic response. If it's coming up from the earth to manifestation or to visibility, it's coming from deep within the earth, working its way through the earth, until it explodes when it manifests. And he talked about the volcanic manifestation. Well, Romans 8:19 says the whole earth does what? It groans in what? Expectation for the manifestation of the sons of God. Verse 21, what does it say? You have to say it louder, babe. I can't hear you. Go ahead. Of the sons of God. 19 says the earth is groaning for the manifestation. The whole earth is groaning. It's not just what's erupting here. It's what's erupting all over the world. Watch. At the same time. And he said there will be multiplied catastrophic events that will take place. And we will be in a time of not just trouble, but the word, the shaking, turmoil. We will be in a time of turmoil. But then he added, see, this is where churchism stops. Because they don't have a revelation from trouble to triumph. I'm talking about dispensationalists. The ecclesiastical church doesn't have an answer, so they stick a catch and away right there because they don't have an answer. Wow. Is that good? Because what if I don't have an answer, what else should I do except get caught up? And you don't understand, in the kingdom, every time a revelation is revealed and activated to you, you're being caught up.
Yes.
The word harpazo means caught up. The Greek word harpazo. And it's to seize a mountaintop. He said, I know you're thinking and going to Thessalonians. He said, he that is alive and remaineth, that is alive and remains, shall harpazo.
Shall be caught up.
So we've created a doctrine right there, because those that early fathers and down through the ages have never been able to define triumph or trouble and triumph. So they separate. There's got to be an end to trouble. And the end of trouble is we leave. No, the end of trouble is the kingdom of God is established. Hallelujah. So harpazo is simply to seize a mountaintop or mountain peak. So every revelation, everything that's revealed, illuminated, activated in your life, you are seizing in your life. Hallelujah. You can only answer for yourself. I cannot wait for the whole church to get in alignment for me to receive revelation. My heart and mind is in alignment. My spirit and soul is in alignment. That alignment is what activates. I may be going through hell out here. Oh, glory. But it won't last. Hallelujah. Somebody say, trouble won't last. I see triumph in your future. Oh, glory. Hallelujah. Tell your other neighbor, trouble won't last always. I see triumph in your future. So now what we do is go to Revelation and make Revelation really that in Daniel, the only literality scriptures or book in the Bible. Because they don't know how to interpret when it comes to spiritual things. They don't know how to take the Logos and turn it to Rhema, so they leave it in Logos. So if I leave it in Logos, now I have got to interpret from a natural mind and put all the days, the months, and the years together to make it fit in my paradigm. But that's why God's shaking everything that can be shaken. He is, what's the word I use, D? He's disrupting the paradigms. I almost said the paradigms of Pentecost, but he's disrupting the paradigms of the church. And the reason he's shaking it, creating disruption, is so we get our eyes off of the trouble and begin to see triumph. And triumph is not you leaving earth. Triumph is you occupying the earth. Oh, glory. I said, you're occupying. Occupy till I come. The Bible literally, in literal terms, and then in the interpretation, whether it's Greek or Hebrew, and then to interpret by the Spirit, it tells us he's coming, but saints, it don't show you saints are going. It says he's coming. And when he comes, you shall be like him, or you shall be like him, which activates his return. He's not going to do a miracle for you and take you to the top of the last mountain when he appears. You've got to be like him. And when God has a remnant, and the word remnant in Revelation 12 is those who have passed through crisis and calamity and survived. Come on, tell your neighbor, I'm in a survival mood here. I'm going to make it. Hallelujah. I said, I'm going to make it. 10,000 demons can come against it, but I'm going to make it. Because there's something in my spirit that says, go ahead. Hallelujah. Tell your neighbor, go ahead. Go on and see what it's going to be. I'll end it right there. 99 and a half won't do. I've got to go for it all. Woo! Hallelujah! 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 So you got to see greater than escapism. Escapism, if I'm running for something or trying to get away from something, it says I'm afraid of something, there's fear, or something is going to destroy me or get me. Well, you've experienced that since birth. He comes to seek and to devour those. The lion comes what? To seek and what? Kill and destroy. He's after the potential is that's in you. He just has to fight your flesh for your flesh to move out of the way that he can kill your potential. Because the more you depress, the more your potential is depressed. The more you're down, the more your potential is down. But the more you grow by renewing your mind, what Pastor said in the Word, that the Logos becomes Rhema, the more you grow and he sees us through the lens of victory and begins to back away. Because I've thrown all my shots at you and nothing brought you down. Tell your neighbor, nothing will bring me down. I'm not moved by any of these things. Paul said, it don't move me. He shot his best shot, but it don't move me. I'm still here, and I know it's the grace of God, by the grace of God, but I determined to keep on living till that grace overshadowed me, and I walked in fullness and as an overcomer. Well, praise God. Woo. We are on the cuff of, as he prophesied, in the midst of all that tribulation and trial, trouble, same thing, trial, tribulation, trouble. See, the paradigm of dispensationalists that have to make everything interpret in the literal because they don't have a spiritual, I said that, understanding. Why would I leave the epistles? All of that has to be interpreted. We see it by the Spirit. Now, you can read it, but it don't do no good. The law killeth. The Spirit gives life. Well, the Spirit gives not only information, but illumination. And then the number three, she said inspiration. That's where somebody's soul catches on fire. Come on, and burn in the Holy Ghost. And what that burning takes place is it's the altar of incense. It's consuming your flesh and preparing you for the kingdom, which is beyond the veil. We got churchism from the brazen altar all the way to the altar of incense. Why do you say the church? Because priests went in there daily. They went through the outer court in the holy place daily to prepare for the day that was coming, which was October 10th, the Day of Atonement. Hallelujah. And we use 7 years of tribulation. The number seven, if it's interpreted spiritually, it's the number of completion and perfection. You will literally step into a saved spirit, a saved soul, and a saved body. See, my spirit is saved. My soul is being saved. That's the renewing process of the mind. And after my mind is renewed, won't have no trouble with my body. He's trying to attack our body, which attacks our mind and lowers the level of revelation in our spirit. What it says, our mind says to our spirit, you can't, you'll never become that. And the truth is, you already are that. In Christ, I am. I said, in Christ, I am. So seven is a number of completion and perfection. And I want to submit to you, since 2020, we have begun, and if I want to even to jump to 2023, there were tremors in 20, 21, and 22. There is much confusion, convulsion, tribulation, and shaking that's going on now. It will continue to rise for the next 7 years. And at the end of that 2030, there is going to be a manifestation of the sons of God. And before the kingdom can establish and we rule all nations, there has to be a manifestation in you. You cannot announce and come in, even though we preach the kingdom of God. We preach it's coming, but in Revelation, the prophetic, it's now. Am I right? I said it's in the now. You'll never get to it if you don't decree it in the now. What's that? The kingdom is within us. And then he said in Matthew 7 that the kingdom of God is within reach. So that's how close. All it takes is the lens of anointing to be able to see what your destiny, future, and potential is. What is my purpose? You've got to climb up the mountain, a place of elevation, so you can see what's coming ahead. And even though we're having the tremors, the tribulation, we're having the troubles, all of things that can be shaken will be shaken. But Hebrews said, but you've received a kingdom which cannot be shaken. What you got to realize is the kingdom is within you. And because it's within me, it belongs to me. And it's a hand's reach. It's a reach. It's all you've got to do is reach for greater. Reach for more. Reach for the basilia of God, the basilia of God. That you rule and reign in royalty. That's what it means. Rule and reign in royalty. Hallelujah. We have a king. He sits high and looks low. He has a kingdom that he rules in. Oh, glory. And that kingdom is you that he rules in. So we need to act like it. Think like it. Until there comes a manifestation of sons, there will be no revealing or manifestation of the kingdom. All it is now is a revelation. And if you have a prophetic revelation, even though you know it's future in the natural mind, it's as close as my hand. It's a hand within reach in my spirit. My mind knows it can be tomorrow, the next day, or 2030. But my spirit talks like it's 2030 and it's only 2023. Glory to God. Somebody say, leave it alone, Bishop. I never thought about mentioning this, but on our next series, one of the things I put up there was choosing five. This time it was totally tabernacle truth. An overwhelming, vote of tabernacle truth. I think we should go to kingdom eschatology on the next one. And I can literally walk you through the anointing of Revelation from 1 to 22. Hallelujah. 20 years ago, I taught the series a new look at an old book and did nothing but teach 7 Tuesday nights on the 7 churches. And then I went from there all the way through 22, 21. How many would like that? Look at that. Well, we in. Now you're going to vote on how quick we start. Got to be sometime the last of April, right? Or the first, yeah. Or in close to May, beginning of May. If you have your notes, look at them. I'm going to briefly scour through some of the things that you have heard, but I want to pull together so we can come to the fullness of this tonight. Under Tabernacle Truths, you have that paragraph, right? Introduction. The Tabernacle of Moses was a portable tent overlaid with various curtains covering draped over a wooden frame. Its overall structure was separated in two general parts. That should go up on the board here for just a minute. You see this, I told you last week, and I think we've got it. Every time I touch this rose, it slides. T. There we go. Now it's not sliding. That's that there. You see it? That's one, the outside perimeter, everything all the way around behind the holy, most holy place, all the way back down from the gate back up is the outer court. All of that's the outer court. It's not a tent. It's an open space. So you've got natural light there, right? But then you don't stay there. We talked about the altar of sacrifice and then the laver. Both the altar sacrifice and the laver was gold. In other words, you're bringing to God a sacrifice that qualifies you to go to the next dimension. None of these dimensions that you see, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, you cannot jump numbers. You cannot jump over one of the articles that are there in the tabernacle. In other words, you can't get to 3. You're at 1. You can't get to 3 without 2. You can't get to 4 without 3, 5 without 4. Am I right? You have to go because God said, set it in according to the pattern, Exodus 25, the pattern that I showed thee. Or verse 8 says, and let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them, according, verse 9, to all that I show thee, after the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all instruments thereof. Even so shall you make it. The pattern of this house has to go through the protocol that has been established to step into the pattern. There's a protocol. You come up the 12 steps. Remember? You come up the apostolic order. That's protocol right there. It says a season of apostles and prophets. Prophets and apostles. Am I right? It should never be prophets introducing apostles. First prophets, first apostles, second prophets. So there should be an apostolic anointing that has governance that can control when you step into the second, which is the prophetic. It's the prophet. And not that all of us have the gifts of certain calling something out, like you see, but all of us have a prophetic nature in us to speak those things as not, as though they were. Is that right?
Yeah, things that are not.
The things that are not as though they were. So it's first apostles. And you got to be very careful. I tell pastors, I told a church Sunday in Atlanta and repeat it tonight. You've got to be very, very careful of allowing prophets in the house without apostolic order. Because they will jack up everything you've been trying to establish for 6 months. Prophets come in and they should come in because it's a part of the fivefold. But hear this, prophets should come in and submit to the apostolic order that's in the house. I've never had, and I should have already made it an established thing, protocol, that when a prophetic word comes in, you need to come and talk to us. And you ask us, is there things I need to steer away from? And I would say, number one, if he asked me, and I'm going to tell him next time or tell them, whoever it is, when they come, you steer away from calling people into leadership in this house. The problem is they see the future but talk like it's now. And immaturity will have you walking in something now that it's going to take 3 years for you to mature to. Well, I'm teaching tonight. All of that's in the pattern. Yeah. God told Moses, I'm speaking to you. I'm not talking to Israel. Y'all quiet right there. So when God talks to this house, he don't talk to you and give you a vision or give you direction or protocol to establish your pattern. He speaks to Moses. Moses tells them how to cut the wood. He tells them the dimensions, the weight of every curtain. He tells them the dimensions of the tabernacle, the dimensions of the holy place and the holy of holies. Congregation don't talk up to Israel or to Moses. That's why when God gave Moses the pattern, he said, leave the people. And you want to show what kind of gullibility they had? They down there taking their gold, didn't know they was going to possibly need that gold, am I right, to make them a golden calf, because they felt like their leader was gone. No, he was just elevated. Look, they were down here. He was just elevated in a mountain that surrounded down here, or that set in down here. But if you hear from God, you've got to ascend to the mountain. And you can't ascend and hear God with dirty hands. You have to have a clean heart. Pure heart. Clean hands and pure heart. If you're going to see God. Moses was on his way. He just asked for one thing. Let me see you. He said, well, I'm going to let you see me. You go up the mountain, that cleft you know about. Climb up in that cleft. And I'm going to let you see my hinder parts. Here's prophetic again. Hinder parts is future. What you see is present. But what behind is behind you is future. But I'm going to take you up the mountain. There's no glory on Israel. Y'all just making it from one stop to the next. Having to fight enemies along the way. But I'm going to come according to Exodus 25 and dwell among you. And watch what happens throughout 25 all the way to chapter 40. It's the glory of God, or they're preparing to house the glory. But the glory only flows where there's order. When you do it according to the pattern, there's no problem with glory. You don't have to preach down glory, sing down glory, shout down glory. Glory is present. Why is it present? Because it's on all of us. Lift your hand. I said it's on all of us. Woo. So 25:8-9 says that. And I want to rush to something else that wasn't in my notes that I need you to see real quick. It's in Exodus. Maybe they can get it. Exodus chapter 40. Or go to 39 first. I think it's the last verse of 39, which is 43. Some of you so fast with your Exodus 39, 43. Now, watch this. This is a good note. From 25 to 30, it's all about, it's great reading. It kind of twists and turns and messes you because we don't work in cubits and we don't work in this and work in that. A cubit foot is 18 inches. He said the kingdom of God's within hand breadth. It's within reach. That's the Bible, in the Old and New Testament, called it a hand's breadth. A hand away, or an arm away, 18 inches away. Which you could break that down, 666. You walking in the beast, y'all quiet. Carnal mind is the beast. It's the beast nature. But you're only 666 from walking into glory. You just got to keep moving. Don't let the six scare you. Six is the number of Adam. He created Adam on the sixth day. All it is, it's not something coming out of Russia, or it's not something coming over here trying to put a computer, little thing, chip in your hand or in your arm or under your hand. It's literally your mind. It's Adamic nature, Adamic nature on steroids gets you to 18. But really, 18 is going to be the kingdom of God. The kingdom is within reach. Oh, glory. Hallelujah. Just because you're facing Adamic setbacks and Adamic upsets and Adamic disruptions, we all in this flesh suit. Nobody's glorified yet because the mind is not renewed. You cannot be glorified until your mind is renewed. Once that mind is renewed, you step into glorification. Oh, hallelujah. None of these things then shall come nigh my dwelling. What does that mean? They know I've tapped into glory. So I'm not coming out of glory just because the enemy wants to fight. Stop fighting what Jesus already triumphed over. You know, everybody is on the warfare kick. Listen, worship. Don't worry about warfare because your worship is really warfare. Your worship activates the heaven, angelic assistance. Hallelujah. Is this good? So in Exodus 39, verse 43, he said, and Moses did look upon the work. 25 to 30, it's all the articles of the tabernacle, inside, outside. It's a great reading. Moses did look upon all the work, and behold, they had done it as he had commanded, as the Lord commanded. Even so, they done it. And Moses blessed them. Now, there was a remnant out of the remnant that came out of Egypt. A remnant came out of Egypt, but then he had begun to establish leadership. Jethro, which is an Old Testament prophet, his father-in-law, the father-in-law of Moses, comes to him and said, look, you're exhausted, you're burnt out, and because you're burnt out, you're burning the people out. He said, you got to set a precedence of protocol here. He said, choose 70 men among you that's got wisdom, that's ready. Know them, he said, prove them, and then present them to me. Bring them to the door of the congregation of the house. When you drop off or bring those 70, God said, I will come and take of the oil that's upon Moses and distribute 70 portions. And the 70 portions is going to handle the 3 million people that come out of Egypt, the Exodus out of Egypt. There was chaos and everybody was burnt out. Until God said, I need you to shift the structure and set in. All of them are not going to get, none of the 70 will get their own anointing. Before you get your own anointing, you've got to work in the anointing of Moses. So by the time we get the tabernacle established, we got those in the tribe of Levi anointed, those in the tribe of Judah that's anointed. He takes a remnant out of all 12 tribes, apostolic order, and brings them as a remnant. And it was the remnant that began to minister in the outer court in the holy place. They were priests under God. I'm excited. I mean, Lord, this is good. Hallelujah. I feel like God when he looked on day 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and said it was good. I'm going to sleep. Hallelujah. I'm going to clock out. It was good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What God is doing, if I just use this room, he's not picking everybody for the same level. He's picking 70 comes from 7. Oh, hallelujah. Everything begins at 0 with God. So that's 70. 70 is complete perfection. It's a process coming into perfection, which means the process means training. The 70 have to get the oil from Moses, 70 quarts of oil, let's say. Each one of them got a measure of oil. But all of them didn't do the same job, but they flowed as leadership. And what they were able to do was go out into Israel because Moses' anointing on them and choose, oh glory, in the congregation who needs to be brought forward or elevated at this season. Because there was so much work that had to be done once the tabernacle was built, and Moses set the articles that in the tabernacle according to the pattern. He couldn't be going through doing all the exercise every day. He couldn't pick a lamb every day. He couldn't slay the lamb every day. He couldn't go to the showbread, to the table of candlesticks, and to the altar of incense 364 days out of a year. He couldn't do it. That's why you got leadership. Oh, glory, glory. And there's something about apostolic anointing that causes leaders to stand out. Well, you'd see them pop like popping popcorn in the audience. I've seen lights that come over people. And I would tell the team, we need that one right there, or this one over here. Because there's something in them that has qualified them for the light to shine on them or to pop like popcorn so Moses can see. And you cannot fuss or be disgusted or depressed who gets chose out of Israel to be a part of the 70, the complete transformation of deliverance. Perfection. And perfection there is never in the scripture two wings. Give me two wings to fly away. No, no. It's never about two wings making you look angelic. Perfection is simply you can be trusted with responsibility. That responsibility don't break you down. So you got a team of perfection that's coming into that dimension, and every part, all 70 have their part in the purpose and the assignment of this tabernacle. Because God anointed them before he built the pattern for Moses to build the tabernacle. Did you get that? He called out the 70, anointed them. God anointed them with the oil on Moses before the tabernacle was structured, constructed, or built. Because God knew Moses couldn't do it all. Now you think, he gave the pattern. And if those two guys kept coming back to Moses saying, are you sure about this? Because it looked like this don't fit with that. No, shut up. Go back to the saw. Go back to the drawing board. It's going to fit when it's all cut and its dimensions are laid out. It never looks like it's fulfilled in the cutting process. But when the knee bone connects to the waist bone, nobody wants to see a knee bone walking around by itself. That's why it's connected to the foot bone, knee bone, waist bone, back bone. Hallelujah. Glory. All right, Exodus now, chapter 40. And Moses blessed them. That's 39. Here is 40. The word S-E-T, set, the word set is given, I think I can write on the side and y'all can see it. The word set is given 12 times in Exodus 40. Starting at verse 4 and going through verse 33. It goes through 33, 4 through 33. The word set is used 12 times. One verse, verse 4 to begin with, has two sets, but is speaking of the same thing. And he set in order the things that were to be set in order. That's 4. But from there on, you only count that as one. It's the same thing. But then from there on, you go literally, if you get this, you can go verse 5, if you're taking notes that quick, verse 5, there's a set, one set. Verse 4, there's one set. Verse 5, one set. Verse 6, one set. Verse 7, one set. Verse 8, one set. 18, one set. 20, one set. 21, one set. 23, one set. 28, one set. 30, one set. And 33, the last set, S-E-T, He's talking about order. Go back and read. Set in order, set in order, set in order. You know, listen, church people get tired of hearing that because they can't see what's coming after that. They have no prophetic unction. If you're connected to the apostolic and the prophetic anointing in this house, watch. You can see what's coming and what the order is going to activate. Yeah. Yeah. So you ain't got no problem hearing set every service. You don't have no problems with taking order or instruction. You don't have no problem holding on to information till it's illuminated. It becomes illumination. Then it becomes a reality or realization. Are you seeing it? So he said 12 times, there it is, set in order. Or set up. He talked about set up the altar, set up the hanging, set up this, set up that. Verse 33 is the last set. That's 12. That's apostolic order. What is apostolic order? Apostolic structure. Apostolos, the Greek is apostolos. Apostolos. Apostolos means elevated with oversight to see the present and the future. It's an oversight. So you don't ever bring an apostolic anointing down to a common contractor. Oh, hallelujah. You've got to let them stay on the mountain so they can hear from God. And hopefully when we come off the mountain with structure and a pattern, we don't find that the saints have put their gold together and built an idol. Oh, hallelujah. That's why Moses, man, he's upset with he broke the tablets. Because he's just like, I've done all this, spent all these days on the mountain. I've been 40 days and y'all have done turned into somebody else. Because all of Egypt hadn't come out of them. So without proper leadership and oversight, all they knew is to revert back to Egyptian mentality and build them an idol that they could worship. They needed something tangible that represented God, and God was nowhere there. You see it? So order, apostolic order is apostolos. It's elevated oversight to see the full view of the parameters of the pattern. Hallelujah. Pastor, you say it again.
No, you say it again.
Apostolic is apostolos. A-P-S-T-O-L-I, or U-S, something like that, or O-S, rather, at the end. Apostolos, L-O-S. It means elevated oversight to see, what did I say there, the perimeter. To what? The full view of the perimeter of the pattern. Is that kind of what it was? Okay, can we go on now? Pastor Keys? He stopped all of us. Say that again. Hallelujah. Well, he's been anointed with the oil. So he's got a voice. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Don't think your voice will always be the tone and on the level it is now. But you can't put people forward that still has Egyptian mentality. Hallelujah. They're not planted. They're just here to see, sing, and shout. To be seen, to sing and shout. But there's others that's not worried about the shimmy, shout, and shake on Sunday. They're here to be planted in the dirt so my mind can be renewed and the purpose and the potential will come to manifestation. That way my tone, come on, and my level will not always be the same. How much are you growing? Hallelujah. I said, how much are you growing? And here, if the children of Israel could have saw or had insight of what was next, they wouldn't have had a problem with setting in order. Moses went up the mountain, came down, gave them the pattern. He gets all the articles together, goes in the tabernacle, and they think he's gone again. He ain't coming out. So they're having to wait again. Carnal-minded folk get in trouble when they have to wait. That's why real leadership, real God-called leadership, can wait on their time. It may be your turn, but it's not your time. Oh, glory. You got to come in this church knowing God's brought me here because I have a turn in the kingdom. There's something in me gnawing away inside of me that says there's more for me. But you got to wait. Here's the process. You got to wait. Even though it's your turn, you got to wait on time. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So verse number 34 answers the questions I've just created. You get everything set in order, 12 sets. Then a cloud. Not until then. First, there's 12 sets. There's government. The next word after the 12th set is then. The protocol of the kingdom is there has to be order in order or government in order that there be glory. Look at it. Then a cloud covered the tent of the congregation, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle, that Moses was not able to enter the tent of the congregation because of the cloud that abode thereon, and the glory of the Lord, the Shekinah, because he had already made a room for God in the Holy of Holies, set up the ark, set up the mercy seat. Am I right? He was prepared for God, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Verse 36, and when the cloud was taken up over the tabernacle, the children of Israel went onward or forward in all their journeys. What are you saying? Don't fall in love with a season. Many times where we have a real encounter with God is where we stop. God didn't give you that divine encounter. I forget y'all over here. If you'll talk, I'll look. Amen. God didn't give you that divine encounter for you to stop, pitch your tent, and not be fluid or flexible to move with the cloud. Why do you want to stay there and the clouds move? That's where ecclesiastical or ecumenical order is today. It's stuck in a season that was wonderful. But if God moves, it ain't wonderful. If he moves, that's why some folks, they have to bounce, because they know when you can predict everything, you know you're in a dead space. You got to get yourself, if you're called to the kingdom, get yourself in an unpredictable church. We do things in decency and order. We have structure. We know when this one's going to speak, when that, when the offering. We know all of that. But we subject to God and the cloud. If the cloud moves off the script, guess what we're going with? We're going to ship with the cloud instead of stay with the script. Because when that cloud moves, I want to get where the cloud is at. Hallelujah. And it doesn't matter who it identifies me with or who it separates me from. Hallelujah. When you're on YouTube and Facebook and you're looking for preachers, look for preachers that are on another level. If you listen 10 minutes and they're just saying the same thing you know, check and go on, because the cloud ain't there. It's amazing how in 1978 there was a cloud on Wilkerson. When I listened to it today, it's the first time I've heard that prophecy, and I've got many of his tapes, or back in the day I did. But when I heard it today, there was a cloud still on it. He's gone, but the cloud is still present. He's in the cloud of witnesses, but there's still a cloud called Shekinah that's on that word that's moving since 78. He released it in 78, and the cloud stayed on it. And this is 2023. Hallelujah. I wonder what's coming out of your mouth. Hallelujah. That's got glory on it, that it's going to come on your children, on your grandchildren, and fill your house. You can't fill the house you live in until your house is full of glory. Going through anointing everything and you ain't anointed. No, it's just an act. It's what we learn to do. You got to anoint. You, what's that?
Learned behavior.
It's learned behavior, yes. And if it ain't working, it, look, if you put the oil on Jimmy, amen, or put it on J-Ray, or Ray J, I got it. If you put it on him and ain't nothing changed, it ain't his fault. It's not a demon that's so tough it won't move. There ain't nothing on you that when your shadow falls on that door, hallelujah, he may be in there, may not be in there, and you put a cross of oil on that door, I'm telling you, he can act like a devil coming through the, coming up on the steps, coming through the door, through the living room, through the hall, but the minute he opens that door, transformation takes place. When he walks through that threshold, cause glory has been in the house. Hallelujah. Somebody shout glory in my house. Shout it from this day on. There shall be glory in my house. Why is there going to be glory in your house? Because there's glory in your house. In your house, there's glory on your house. When the cloud moved, was taken up, they journeyed forward because they moved, what? With the cloud. It's 8:21. What did I want to eat last Wednesday? And it was closed at 9. We sit back there and talk and it closed on you. You ever get your mouth all ready for it and your mind on edge ready for it? Then it's closed. They ain't, ever who it was, they ain't going to close on me tonight. That's what I was wanting to say. She said, that ain't the glory. I think you've got, if you study these notes and look at them, you have, and have a picture of the tabernacle. You can pull one up, Google tabernacle. You'll have 2,400 different views of the tabernacle. And get the simplest. Don't get the one that's got all the dimensions in it. I get confused. I just back up to the simplest structure, and then I allow the anointing to set on that and extract the purpose of that article and make it realization to us. Am I right? You remember Logos, the table of showbread. You remember Rhema, the candlesticks. You remember when things broke loose last Wednesday at the altar of incense. Hallelujah. When the priest was translated in within the veil, holding the bowl of worship in his hands. You got that? We got that. The table, the law, tablets of the law were in the Holy of Holies. In the ark. It was laid in the ark. And also Aaron's rod that budded. Now Moses' law speaks of Mosaic law. Mosaic or Levitical law. When he said Aaron's rod was in there that continued to bud, even though it was cut down from the vine, extracted. But now watch, you cut it down, you cut everything off that stick so you won't get stuck with what's on the stick. That make any sense? Right, so you, I can't say it again. The anointing only comes one time for one thought. One thought, one time. It's when he, like he said, say it again. I could not remember what I was saying. I say it so fast because it comes so fast. That is the absolute truth. Y'all start responding, and it don't always have to be a clap or standing or lift your hand or hallelujah. Your spirit's responding because you've told your mind shut up. Because you can't go forward with your mind trying to rule and dictate your journey. And the more your mind kicks up a fuss, the more you know you are moving in the right direction. Hallelujah. Oh, I did. That's right. Verse 34, the first word is then. It's called, I call it the hinge of glory. The hinge of glory. That then is a hinge. You set up the door. You get the doorknobs all in place. Then you got the hinges. And when you open the door, the hinges takes you into another, because the hinges are there to open the door. It takes you into another dimension. So there's first government. These are good notes right here. Government is first. Then we just read glory. So the more government or order there is, the greater the glory. The greater the government, the greater the glory. That ends Exodus, and we begin with Leviticus. Leviticus, the first seven chapters, go home and read it, Bible study for us. The first seven chapters is given to gold. He literally tells Israel what offerings to bring. He names the offering. Sheaf offering, heap offering, this offering, that offering. First Sunday, this offering. Second Sunday, this offering. He tells them what the offerings and what they meant. Hallelujah. So the Leviticus now is given to gold. The greater the glory, the greater the government, the greater the glory. The greater the glory, the greater the gold. Hallelujah. Government, glory, and gold. Say it with me. Government, glory, and gold. Hallelujah. Y'all could write it faster if y'all would put them phones down, get you a pad, get you a Sharpie and some paper. I was asking Rose, I think it was last Wednesday, I said, can you bring me a tablet, a legal pad? And she stood there for a second, then she said, we ain't got no legal pads. I said, oh, wait before you walk out. You telling me in this whole God-ordained church and all the offices that there around, you can't find me a legal pad? I said, well, somebody needs to make a trip to Office Supply. I asked for a legal pad. Pastor, in her drawer, if you pull it open, she got millions and millions and millions of Sharpies.
I do.
She does. That ain't no lie. And listen, she said, well, we hadn't got any. I said, did we run out? I mean, don't run out. And she said, no, we didn't run out. We don't use legal pads. We don't write nothing. I said, that's your problem. You're going to stay in the outer court right there because you don't write nothing. Oh, I got two writers right here, right there. I got a writer with a paper Bible. Amen. A hand of a ready writer. It didn't say nothing about a hand, the finger, a pen of a ready writer. It didn't say nothing about the finger of a phone, iPhone.
A pen of a ready writer.
I try to take notes there, too. In my phone, but I'm slow because I can't type. We looked at the outer court that surrounds the tent, sides, front, and back, front, sides, and back. And then we looked at the two tent, or the Holy of Holies and the most holy place. The holy place and the most holy place is a tent. And it was divided also by a curtain. Going from the outer court into the holy place, there was a curtain that the high priest can pick up and go through, or an adjutant would hold and he could go through. A servant in the tabernacle could hold and he could go through. But he couldn't get through the veil that was between the holy place and Holy of Holies. It took the process of protocol to get him ready on that Day of Atonement at one month. which was the 10th day of October. It took an anointing to translate him, not translate, but yeah, translate him into the Holy of Holies. That Aaron's rod, and I'll leave the tabernacle for a moment and give you something. Aaron's rod, taken from the life of the source of the tree, connected the roots. He trimmed it just as a staff. It was a rod. It helped him walk up the mountains, you know, and cross the desert. Now, how could that thing all of a sudden that was lifeless return back to its original state as though it was still connected as a limb, a vine connected to a tree, connected to roots? That's the only way it can bud. He's taken it, and they put, Moses put Aaron's rod into the Ark of the Covenant, which says to me it's going back to the original intent of blooming, and it blossomed, which is the order of Melchizedek. You've got Levitical order or Mosaic order, the tablets, but now you got Melchizedek priesthood because it's an order of endless life. Do you understand the priest, Melchizedek, the priesthood, the priest of righteousness, and the priest of peace? Amen. You've got Melchizedek, and he had, the study was, he had no beginning of days, nor ending of days. So the Spirit of God had to dwell there. He was a Christophanes. In other words, he appeared before the man Jesus appeared in the manger. He appeared in the spirit to Moses, or to Abraham in Genesis 14. But watch, it continued to bud. It went back to its original intent. What's happening now is we are being in the spirit translated back to the original intent of God. It's where we tend the garden, and everything in the garden is endless. Adam didn't see it to begin, so to him it had no beginning of days, and certainly didn't have no ending of days until the serpent came to the woman. So we're going back. That represents in that ark that he was taking that branch back to its original intent. Impossible to bloom, but it's in the glory. It's in the ark, and the ark is sitting there with the mercy seat, with the Shekinah, literally a cloud, over that Ark of the Covenant. So whatever's dead, whatever's drying up in your life, whatever you see drying up round about you, God wants to bring it back to the Garden of Eden, back to the original intent where there's life and the reproduction of life. That's not more kids. That means everything you touch is replenished before you use it. I told you, you pull a pear off, a peach off, and a peach appears before you can get it to your mouth. It replenishes. It's a Melchizedek priesthood. No beginning and no ending. It's endless life. Also, Melchizedek mentioned in Hebrews. So it's in the new covenant. Mosaic covenant is the Old Testament, the old covenant. It's the law. Am I right about it? What we're doing now is taking the old law, that which was a shadow of things to come. We go back and take that shadow. We don't try to rebuild it literally, but we take the rhema of the pattern and of the old covenant, Old Testament, bring it into being justified by faith and making it work in the new covenant through the sacrifice of the blood of Christ on the cross. Is that good? Yeah. Amen. I want you to run down with me. I think we have the, you have the notes, I think, of the Revelation of Threes. Yeah. should be your last page. Is it last week? I thought it was supposed to be a part of this. It's on the back page of this week?
Yeah.
Okay.
I didn't get one.
You didn't? I talked about all the threes that we see in Scripture. I talked about, remember, Jacob, Israel, Jezreel. The Lord has straightened me out. He qualified, he created, means qualified, a heel catcher. But he squeezed into shape through a narrow passage, Israel. Squeezed means through, form means squeezed into shape. And we're going to end the series here. I'm just going to read down through them. There's scripture, and this could be homework and study. Go through scripture and find out where spirits mention, souls mention, bodies. Sometimes they're together. Sometimes they're separate. Find where Savior Christ the Lord, that's Luke 2:11, Savior Christ the Lord. We read about Passover, Pentecost, and Tabernacles. The first one is, obviously, you see it there, is outer court. The middle one, in other words, Savior's outer court, Christ's its holy place. The Lord is the most holy place. You find it? Or see it? Passover, Pentecost, Tabernacles is in a holy place. Mount Moriah represents the outer court, or Mount Ophel represents the outer court. Moriah, the holy place. Zion, the most holy place. Justification, outer court, sanctification, and then the most holy place where you'll find glorification is on Mount Zion. There's 30, 60, 100 fold in the kingdom. Watch. There's babes. There's young men. And in the third dimension, there's a man-child overcomer. Man-child overcomer. We us overcomers. Full-grown, matured sons. Overcomers. Outer courts, you got milk for babes. You got meat in the holy place for young men. You see it right back up there, two above that. And then you got hidden manna right above it for the man-child company. In other words, those first two dimensions, you have to have substance, yeah. Right? But the third dimension, it's hidden manna. Your spirit has to be open and your mind subjected to your spirit to find hidden manna or see it. It's revelation knowledge. It's what Pastor talked about. Then you got the way, the truth, the life, faith, hope, and love, thanksgiving, outer court, praise in the holy place. That's where the church is at now, but we're shifting because we're at the altar of incense. Mm-hmm. Right now, the church is at the altar of incense. We're waiting for that translation into the third dimension, which is worship. Mm-hmm. All you can do in the third dimension is worship. You can shout, dance, and run around the holy place, but the closer you get, the more still you get. And then it's a heart relationship. Hallelujah. You have prophet, Old Testament, priest, and king, three offices that were anointed in the Old Testament, Old Covenant, prophet, priest, and king. Outer court, I talked about, you have natural light. A holy place is covered. It's behind a thin veil, but it's covered. Covered over in the sides and the front. And you have artificial light, the candlesticks. But there is no light in the third dimension, the Holy of Holies, except the Shekinah. It's divine light. You talked about a lamp unto my feet, light to my path. You've got natural light, artificial light, divine light. Then John 15, you got fruit, more fruit, and much fruit. Hallelujah. Read that one. You got birthright, outer courts. You got blessings in the holy place, but you have inheritance. Hallelujah. You were in Egypt, but you had a birthright. You wasn't a part or shouldn't be part of Egypt. You were quarantined to the land of Goshen. Amen. But they ate from the Egyptians, so they grew like the Egyptians. But there was their birthright, blessing, and then the Canaan is the inheritance. Here it is, out of Egypt, through the wilderness, into the land. That's the land of promise. You got baptism in water, baptism in the Spirit, and then baptism in fire. The baptism of fire is when the Shekinah begins to rest on you, the glory of God. Now, it comes in intervals according to assignment, because we could not handle, this flesh couldn't handle the Shekinah resting on us 24/7. You would be crazy. Your mind would be just crazy because you couldn't handle the glory that long still in the flesh. So you got baptism in spirit and in fire. First the water. First heaven, second heaven, third heaven. Talking about Paul. Called up to the first, the second, and the third. So it's outer court revelation. There's holy place revelation. And then there's holy of holies revelation. First anointing, second anointing, third anointing. David had three anointings. He was anointed in the midst of his brethren, then anointed over Judah, and the third anointing was over all of Israel. Three anointings. Hallelujah. Divine healing. You walk in divine healing till you get to a place. You move to the next dimension, which is divine health. Then you move to the third dimension, where that Aaron's rod is budding, which is divine life. Revelation talks about, and you can see it, the remnant of her seed, the sun-clothed woman, and a man-child company. And this is what I taught, seed concealed, revealed, and fulfilled. That was the second message I ever taught. I was caught up in the spirit for an hour and 20 minutes, didn't know pastor sitting that close, and didn't see anybody. I don't know where I went and what happened, but I was preaching from Ephesians 1, you're accepted in the beloved, and all of a sudden I just stopped and I started quoting all 17 verses of Revelation chapter 12. I quoted and put it in a package called the seed concealed within the womb. She gave birth, that's the seed revealed. And the seed fulfilled is in verse 10, where it talks about, and I heard a loud voice saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. It's now. Now is the kingdom of heaven. So that's the seed fulfilled. I trust I can ask this, and you'll be honest. Have we, just any one of the 4 weeks blessed you, or three of them, or all four of them? I celebrate all of you that's been here. 3, 4, 3, 2, 1. Amen. And sometimes when you have new coming in that hadn't had an opportunity to be here, that's why you go back as a teacher and you summarize where you've just taken the people. Amen. So everybody be on the same page. Next session, next Wednesday nights. We're going to charge $399 because I know if you pay it, you got an investment, you'll show up. I want us to get an offering ready. I looked at the numbers yesterday, and we need no less than $1,500 tonight. That would sound like we're going back into churchism, but I was watching our giving. It was great. Then it went down, went back up a little bit. And there's a certain number I want to reach every month on our Wind Nights so we can. It ain't cheap to open this building. And, you know, security, you have to pay security. And thank God for all the volunteers, but there's things that have to be done. Yes, children's ministry. Don't leave your kids tonight. Don't be caught up in the spirit and like you're on a mountain and just drive off the mountain toward home. Stop by. Stop by and pick them up. Amen. I want you to give with a grateful heart tonight. I've always taught that seed, when seed has been sown, seed then, when seeds have been sown, seeds of revelation, and you put a natural seed with it, it literally seals. Seed and seed seals. It seals the truth. And the truth begins to grow. Amen. If you want y'all's to grow overnight, $1,000. I'm telling you, that seed's going to just blossom. Y'all didn't get it. Did you get it? Amen. You got what?
We got a lot tonight.
Well, I tried to stop after you said you done.
We did.
You just stopped on a high note and expected me to pitch it that high. I don't have that range. Amen. Get it ready. If you need an envelope, certainly there's one in the pocket, in front of you, pocket seat in front of you. Father, we thank you tonight for your endless love. We thank you for the spirit of justification. We thank you for our birthright. Father, we thank you for understanding the anointings of first and second and third anointings. Father, I thank you for the three dimensions of Uranos, the nature of maturity, heaven, Uranos. I thank you that, God, we're moving into those dimensions of maturity. Continue to mature your people. Hallelujah. That we can stand up as a mighty nation, as the kingdom of God. In the mighty name of Jesus. Use this church. Mature this house from the front to the back, the left to the right. Don't let and allow anyone to go untouched by your anointing that will mature us. Create hunger. Thank you, Jesus. We bless your name. All the saints said amen.
Can we thank God for Bishop, who has labored, poured out his heart, put the word in the atmosphere? Thank you, Bishop. We are not going to be the same. We're not going to just hear this word with our natural ears and not apply it to our lives.
If they hadn't been open spirits. I said we could have never traveled this far. A teacher that's teaching revelation knowledge can go only as far as your spirit is open. When you shut down, it shuts down. Amen. So I thank you so much for your attendance, your giving, your sacrifice, all those that are online that are part of the local church and others around the country. Thank you. Sow a seed tonight. Amen. And get right on in on this, God sealing the revelation of truth.
Amen. Amen. Lord, tonight we say thank you for speaking your word in this place. Thank you for hunger. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for fruit, more fruit and much fruit. We thank you, Lord, that the revelation of worship has been released afresh and anew in this house. Thank you, God, that we will enter your gates with thanksgiving and come before your courts with praise. We come expecting your glory. We come expecting it on a whole new level, Father. We thank you, Lord, for every person that has labored to make this series happen. We ask that you would bless us now, Lord, as we leave this place. Give us traveling mercies, God. Let this word bubble up in our spirit. And Father, we will never fail to give your name all of the glory and all of the honor and all of the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Touch somebody around you.